Reality Tunnels, Monologues by Robert Anton Wilson, Alan Watts, and Terence McKenna.
If you take history on this planet as starting at midnight, and you assume the life of a planet is 15 billion years, which is the estimated life of a G-type star, it is now 8 o'clock in the morning, and it's time for us to wake up, because we've pretty much been operating on autopilot up until now, and there are signs of planetary awakening. Domesticated primate psychology remains pretty much the same as it was in the Paleolithic, but one sees increasing evidences of mutations. There was only one Buddha 2,500 years ago. Now you meet 5 or 10 Buddhas at every city you go to. Knowledge, wherever it is discovered, is traveling the whole world faster and faster. The possibility of changing consciousness was discovered in the Orient 2,500 years ago, at least. It's probably older than that. But techniques were discovered to quiet the mind, pacify the mind, remove emotion, and these were organized into the science of yoga. As John Lilly says, yoga is the science of the East, as science is the yoga of the West. Science is a yoga too. Science is a way of trying to reach an objective level in which your emotional compulsions and prejudices aren't twisting all the facts to fit in with your favorite reality tunnel. The scientific worldview grew up in the West between 1500 and 1750, largely due to mystics who were known as hermeticists. This hermetic scientific revolution saw theology as its enemy, and there was no conflict between hermeticism and science. They were both based on experiment. Find out what happens if you do this. And they were both opposed to the authority of the church. Shortly after 1600, this began to split, and the hermetic tradition faded into the background, and we developed for the first time in history a science that had no connection with anything except pure reason. The hermetic tradition was that there is no such thing as pure reason. You've got to first work on your own perceiving apparatuses to correct your prejudices, and the scientist is not separate from what the scientist observes, and the general yogic attitude that you are the master who makes the grass green. Western science lost that insight. And from Newton onwards, we had the idea that it doesn't matter who you are, if you follow scientific procedure, you'll find the truth. This began to break down after 1900 due to Sigmund Freud, who pointed out that even scientists are human beings who may have neuroses, and that scientific theories may be elaborate rationalizations for neuroses. And the influence of Karl Marx, who pointed out that no matter what you're theorizing about, it's a mirror of your economic status and what your economic goals are. And then anthropologists started coming back with reports of alternative reality tunnels showing that no matter what reality tunnel you live in, the world will organize itself in your perceptions to be compatible with that reality tunnel. So science began to have data to look at science itself, critically. That's how intelligence increases, when intelligence looks at intelligence and criticizes intelligence. So quantum physics turned out to be saying exactly the same thing that the psychedelic revolution was saying, that there is no objective reality separate from us. All we know is the reality that we are co-creators of, the reality perceived, conceived, put together by our nervous systems. And at this point, it becomes obvious that intelligence can be raised, consciousness can be altered, nothing is static. All we got to do is learn to change our nervous systems, and we can go to wider and wider reality tunnels and bigger levels of perception and so on. And so there was a great deal of drug research, and a lot of people were getting a lot of radical ideas, and so the government made it illegal, which is the natural thing to do if you're a politician. The last thing you want is intelligence increase. So then some others start saying, well, okay, they won't let us investigate drugs, but now that we know it's possible to change consciousness, let's see the other techniques that they will let us investigate. Nobody has made pranayama illegal yet because it would be impossible to enforce. What, do you just have to read a book on yoga and learn how to breathe through alternative nostrils and you find you go into an entirely different consciousness state? Then you go back to your ordinary consciousness, think about that state, then go back into that state and think about your ordinary conscious, and already you're in I squared. You're in intelligence studying intelligence. You're finding out how your nervous system works. With each decade since the 1960s, we're moving more and more to the place where we can change our nervous systems, change our reality tunnels, and make bigger and bigger reality tunnels. Once you look down at your reality tunnel, whether your reality tunnel is a Ohio Methodist or a New York Jewish or a Marine County hippie or Tokyo capitalist Zen Buddhist or a Iranian Muslim fundamentalist, once you get to the level where you're outside your reality tunnel looking down at it, you can compare reality tunnels, and then you're on a higher level of intelligence already because you're no longer a conditioned mechanism just following the reality tunnel that was accidentally imprinted or conditioned, and you can start choosing between reality tunnels. Why don't you really know what you want? Two reasons that you don't really know what you want. Number one, you have it. Number two, you don't know yourself, because you never can. The Godhead is never an object of its own knowledge. Just as a knife doesn't cut itself, fire doesn't burn itself, light doesn't illumine itself, it's always an endless mystery to itself. And this I don't know, uttered in the infinite interior of the spirit, this I don't know is the same thing as I love. I let go. I don't try to force or control. It's the same thing as humility. If you think that you understand Brahma, you do not understand, and have yet to be instructed further. If you know that you do not understand, then you truly understand, for the Brahma is unknown to those who know it, and known to those who know it not. And the principle is, any time you, as it were, voluntarily let up control, in other words, cease to cling to yourself, you have an excess of power, because you're wasting energy all the time in self-defense, trying to manage things, trying to force things to conform to your will. The moment you stop doing that, that wasted energy is available. Therefore, you are, in that sense, having that energy available, you are one with the divine principle. You have the energy. When you try, however, to act as if you were God, that is to say, you don't trust anybody, and you're the dictator, and you try and keep everybody in line, you lose the divine energy. Because what you are doing is simply defending yourself. So then the principle is, the more you give it away, the more it comes back. Now you say, I don't have the courage to give it away, I'm afraid. And you can only overcome that by realizing you'd better give it away, because there is no way of holding on to it. The meaning of the fact you see that everything is dissolving constantly, that we're all falling apart, we're all in the process of constant death, and that the worldly hope men set their hearts upon turns ashes, or it prospers and anon, like snow upon the desert's dusty face, lightning a little hour or two and is gone, and all that Omar Khayyam jazz. You know, the cloud-capped towers, the gorgeous palaces, the solemn temples, the great globe itself, aye, all that it inherits shall dissolve, and like this insubstantial pageant faded, leave not a rack behind. All falling apart. Everything is. That's the great assistance to you. The fact that everything is in decay is your helper. That is allowing you that you don't have to let go because there is nothing to hold on to. It is achieved for you, in other words, by the process of nature. Once you see you just don't have a prayer, it's all washed up, and that you will vanish and leave not a rack behind, and you really get with that, suddenly you find you have the power, this enormous excess of energy. But it is not the power that came to you because you grabbed it. It came in entirely the opposite way. Power that comes to you in an opposite way is power with which you can be trusted.
Well, where to begin? That's always the question. There are ideas, personalities, technologies, available right now, which, if honestly explored and implemented, could rescue the human enterprise from the disgrace that hovers over us. We don't want this to end in a toxified garbage pit ruled by Nazis, which is, you know, the way we may well be headed. The guy in mind has always been there. Nature, originally, through the plants and shamanism, provided the tools for us to access this incredible natural database. Through the vicissitudes of history, previous generations lost the key in Western society. Since the 1960s, the key has been refound. It's a matter of great social controversy. It's a matter of a great risk to those who take it, how they will be viewed by their peers. But there is no longer ignorance is no longer an excuse. Anthropology in the last 100 years has laid at our doorstep the tools necessary for an archaic reconstruction of society and human values within that society. It's inconceivable that Western industrial capitalism could run on another 500 or 1,000 years. It will not continue as it has. It will deteriorate under the pressure of resource scarcity. And what few democratic values we have obtained, what little space for reasoned discourse has been created, will be the first to be swept away. So it's very, very important that people take back their minds and that people analyze our dilemma in the context of the entire human story, from the descent onto the grassland to our potential destiny as citizens of the galaxy and the universe. We are at a critical turning point. And as I say, the tools, the data that holds the potential for our salvation is now known. It is available. It is among us. But it is misrepresented. It is slandered. It is litigated against. It's up to each one of us to relate to this situation in a fashion that will allow us to answer the question that will surely be put to us at some point in the future, which is, what did you do to help save the world?